these are all my mountain bikes, or, well, it's not really all my mountain bikes, but the other ones are just there for demonstration purposes. These I actually ride. They're always running, they have fresh sealant in them. I care about what parts they have on them, how they're adjusted, and so today, I'm gonna tell you all about them. So before we get into it and talk about individual bikes, let me tell you a little bit about my fleet as a whole, because for the first time since starting this YouTube channel, I'm really, really happy with my fleet. I feel really good about it. Now, when you have a bunch of bikes that are designed for the same thing, it leads to decision paralysis. And now I can easily decide which bike I'm gonna ride depending on what I'm gonna be doing. It should go without saying that if I'm doing some dirt jumping, I'm gonna take out my dirt jump bike. If I'm exploring, really pedaling and going places, I'm gonna take my titanium Sage. If I'm riding with my daughter, or if I'm hitting weird features on Berm Peak, I'm gonna take my black hardtail. And if I'm gonna be going down a really long, chunky descent or riding a bike park, I'm gonna take out my Revel rail because that's what it's built to handle. Now, you might have noticed by now that these bikes are all kind of dirty. And that's because I wanted to show you the bikes in their natural state. They're only clean for like a minute every week or month. And so let's start with this one. So first of all, what a strange bike. I posted a video last week about this thing and I didn't even go over all the things that are weird about it. So we'll start with the fact that it has a lefty, it's mixed wheel, 29 in the front, 27.5 in the rear. It has a Chinese electronic shifting system, and as far as I know, it's the only one working right now in North America, because as soon as we posted the video, the whole website vanished, which is strange because this EDS wireless shifting system has been performing flawlessly. Also weird about this bike, we did a video where we filled at least most of the down tube with expansion foam, and we found it actually made the bike quieter. Also weird, bird spokes. It's almost like building your wheels out of string, but this is very well engineered string. It's strong, the wheels have a really, really good ride quality. It's almost like an acoustic property to the wheels. As you're rolling down the trail, the vibrations you feel and hear through the bike are just different, and I think they're better. Another weird thing about this bike, this is a wireless dropper seat post, and as far as I know, it's the first wireless dropper seat post to ever hit the market. It's the Magura Viron. It's reliable enough, but it's not perfect. There's a big delay when you hit the button, but I'm used to it, and like I said, it's reliable enough. I haven't had any problems with it. Also weird, Rev grips. We did a video a few years back basically bashing these things because they're $90. How could you possibly justify a $90 grip? Well, once you buy the $90 grip, you can replace the casings that go around it for, I don't know, 20, 25 bucks or something, which is also kind of expensive. But I still have them on my bike. In fact, this is another pair of them because I grew to really like them. So of course, last week we put the lefty Ocho on this bike, and this is a cross-country fork with 120 millimeters of travel, but we know it's stiff, we know it's strong, and so that's why I put it on this trail bike, to just make it weirder and make the geometry work with the mixed wheels. An older set of TRP G-Spec brakes on this bike. I love them. They honestly don't feel any different than any of TRP's new brakes. They're all good. And we've got an oblong chainring on this bike, also from 1UP. So since doing this experiment with the lefty and the mixed wheels, I'm kind of re-honeymooning this bike. I want to ride it all the time because it just feels really cool. And I think the conversion actually made it better for the Mac Ride. There's enough stack over here to attach the little Mac Ride adapter. I'm never riding anything that rough when I'm with her, and so a hardtail is good, it pedals well. And my other hardtail is like a titanium masterpiece, and I don't wanna put the Mac Ride adapter on it. And so this is my dad bike. So this next bike is my Revel Rail, and this is my big bike. And when I say big, I'm not talking about the size of the rider that would ride the bike. That would be small. But the travel on this bike is pretty big, even for an enduro bike. It's got 180 millimeters in the front and 165 in the rear. And so you can take this thing to a bike park. This will handle anything. Now, as many of you know, I don't have a downhill bike because I wouldn't be able to ride it enough to even get used to it. That could change now that we have both Canuga and and Rock Creek within striking distance. But for the meantime, I use this kind of like a downhill bike. If I'm gonna ride something big and gnarly, this is the one I use. And if I'm gonna go on a big ride that I know has lots of chunk, this thing pedals just fine. It climbs great. Now this bike has 27.5 inch wheels. That's like becoming less and less popular. Even my bike fleet is starting to become more 29, but at the same time, I'm a small rider. And so 29 inch wheels feel pretty big to me. They actually change my ability to handle the bike. And so if I'm going over big jumps or through really technical stuff, I just want to stick to what I'm comfortable with. And so indeed, this is 27.5. This bike has SRAM access. That means the shifting and the dropper post are both wireless. So I have fewer cables up here and looks cool, works great. And speaking of the dropper post, there's a really weird story about it. As you can see, the battery is on the front, underneath the nose of the saddle. If you're familiar with SRAM access, you know that the battery is normally on the back, but because this bike is a size small, when I went off of big jumps and drops and bottomed out the rear of the bike, the back wheel was actually hitting into the battery and ripping it out of the dropper post. We did this whole video where we tried to figure out a solution to it. In the end, I just hacksawed this little limiting screw out from inside the dropper post, spun it around, and then found a seat that would clear the battery, and that's kind of a perfect solution. Now, the rest of the parts that the bike was spec'd with, I had absolutely no reason to change. It's got Industry 9 hubs, X01 cranks. You've got a RockShox Zeb up front, which is amazingly smooth. Now, unless you've been following this channel really closely, it might come as a surprise that I have tool storage on this bike. I have everything you would need, flat repair, inflation, all of it, and you can't see it anywhere. And so here I have a set of wrenches. That is by no means a complete set of tools. So here in the handlebar, made by Lazine, we can pull this little guy out. And then you're gonna see here, I have a tubeless insert kit. But that's not all. Over here, you can see this fork cork. You turn this, and then this guy comes out. CO2 and an inflator. Now this fork cork is a product that's available from miles wide. You can find it on Amazon, all over the internet. And I took one piece of it apart and 3D printed this, just pressure fits a CO2 in there, and then I lightly screwed a little inflator on the top, and so I have my tire inflation up in here. The only thing this bike is missing, tool-wise, is a chain tool, but I believe Lazine makes one that I can put in the other side of the handlebar. This is my dirt jump bike, and it was actually given to me by Eric Porter, and he set most of it up. But there are a few things that I changed on it. Now, first of all, I believe this is a 2014 Diamondback Assault, and Eric had changed out pretty much everything on it, but the wheels came from me. These are Industry 9 wheels made right here in Asheville, and they're real light, real nice. And we tore this down and re-powder coated the frame. It's like a semi-matte black color. I don't know, I probably would have gone glossy if I could do it over. I like a glossy dirt jumper. So I haven't been getting too technical, but I do want to talk about dirt jumper geometry just for a minute. Now, if you're not into dirt jumpers and you had to guess the head tube angle of a dirt jumper, what do you think it would be? Most people will probably say, oh yeah, it's got to be slack like a downhill bike because it's made for hitting jumps. Wrong. Dirt jump bikes have steep head tube angles. This has a 69 degree head tube angle. By comparison, my black hardtail has a 66 degree head angle. And even my Sage that I use for kind of exploring has a 66 and a half degree head tube angle. So it's got a steeper head tube angle than some cross country bikes. On a dirt jump bike, you're doing bar spins. You are doing little twitchy things to position yourself for jumps. You're also hitting these big steep lips. That's an uphill thing. Steeper head tube angles better. Now, as I said, Eric Porter set up this bike. Eric's a really big guy. And so one change I made to the bike was slam the rear wheel in the dropout, try and shorten up the chainstay. I'd imagine a significant amount of you don't know what that means. This is the chainstay, and the length of the chainstay where your wheel sits in it can have a pretty big effect on how the bike rides, even if it's a little tiny bit. I'm 5'4". I like a really short chainstay. I like short bikes in general. And so I was actually able to move the wheel in the dropout and get it closer to the front of the bike by shortening the chain. And in order to do that, I had to use a half link chain. Each link is actually half of a normal link. You can accomplish the same thing by taking a normal chain and putting one half link in it, but a half link chain looks cooler. Now I have Crank Brothers stamped pedals on this bike. I use the same pedals for dirt jumping as I do for trail riding. Eric had some bigger platform pedals on it. Especially for dirt jumping, I prefer small platform pedals because if you take your foot off the bike and put it back on, if the pedal is at kind of a weird angle, it sort of walks your foot. So the smaller the pedal, the less it walks your foot. Now a lot of dirt jump bikes just have one brake just in the rear to kind of adjust your speed a little bit. And Eric put a Magura MT8 on this bike. It is fantastic. The way the lever feels, I barely have to do any maintenance to it. It's just a fantastic brake. And the only reason that I don't have MT8s on every single one of my bikes is that I'm just not a good enough mechanic to work on them. Every time I have to align the caliper or something, I just feel like an idiot. But you can't deny that they're unbelievably amazing brakes when they're working right. And this one is. There's also a Fox 36 in this bike. Fox now offers Marzocchi products for their dirt jumpers. It's more or less the same as the Marzocchi stuff with just better parts everywhere. But he put a Fox 36 on it and reduced it to like, I don't know, it must be 100 millimeters of travel or something. Not only do dirt jumpers have head angles similar to cross-country bikes, but they also have travel similar to cross-country bikes because you just don't need a whole lot of travel when dirt jumping and in fact, a lot of travel can be detrimental. You want the bike to be really stiff and responsive. Now this bike is at least 8 years old now. It's pretty old for a bike in my fleet. And you could consider it out of date, except that dirt jumpers just don't change all that much from year to year. And so I have no plans to replace it. I feel really comfortable, really confident on this bike. And I'll probably have it for as long as I have the wherewithal to go dirt jumping. This is Blue, my titanium hardtail. And I use this for any time I know I'm gonna be pedaling. I use this for long rides, rides that are gonna have a lot of ups and downs. This is kind of like my cross-country-ish bike. And the main thing that makes it so good for that is I designed and planned it out that way. I wanted a bike that fit me perfectly, and so I worked with Sage, a manufacturer of titanium hardtails, to modify the geometry of their Sage power line to fit me perfectly, and it does. Now, another thing that makes it great for exploring and getting lost in the mountains is it has two bottle cages. Not all bikes can fit two bottle cages, and when you're a small person like me, it's even more rare. Now, we went into like two videos worth of detail about this bike, and so I'm gonna keep this pretty basic. The fork is a Fox 34, and it has 130 millimeters of travel. I find that that's the sweet spot for all-around riding. It does have SRAM access all around, dropper post, and shifting. Didn't have to hack up the dropper post because it's not a full suspension bike, and so never gonna hit the rear wheel. As you can see, I have a fast rolling tire in the back, and I have a knobby one up front. For the type of riding I do with this bike, that's gonna give you less rolling resistance, but still enough grip up front to make it through loose turns. And because I always want to be prepared, I have some pretty comprehensive tool storage here. I have a 1UP EDC up in the front, and I have this little Rock Bros Amazon pump that's actually quite good. And you can even screw a CO2 into it. And if I want to carry other things, I had them install this mount on the top of the frame. It's a little riv nut, and I can 3D print things I've shown in other videos and attach them to the top of the frame, carry some extra stuff. Now, if you take a close look at this bike, you're gonna notice it's got some really good high-end parts on it, and that was kind of the goal. I wanted to build one bike where I just pull out all the stops and really treated myself. And so, it's got a set of 29-inch bird wheels. I have Industry 9 hubs, front and rear, made right here in Asheville. And also made right here in Asheville, Cane Creek E-wings, titanium cranks, and these ones are 165 millimeters. They're a little bit shorter than almost any crank that would come with a bike. I have short legs. Feels really good pedaling on some shorter cranks. You'll also notice I have mallet pedals on here. I have clipless pedals. Like I said, this bike is for exploring, and I really like clipless pedals when I'm not trying to do anything crazy. So I prefer to have that immediate extra power if you find yourself in a weird situation and you need to get up a punchy climb or through something technical. Now, I chose titanium for the frame material for a lot of reasons. First of all, I've always wanted a titanium bike. They're beautiful, they're light, they're extremely strong, and titanium as a material provides a really nice ride quality. But also, it's infinitely repairable because doesn't fatigue. This can last my entire life. Carbon fiber frames will actually experience some fatigue over their lifetime, even alloy frames. And so titanium is really cool. So part of me having this bike built completely custom was the paint job. They actually talked me into the paint job. I just wanted it raw. I wanted it titanium from top to bottom with nothing written on it. But I'm glad I went with the paint job because it makes the bike a whole lot more unique, and the painter was able to hide all sorts of Easter eggs in the paint. I'll show you a couple of them. We got North Carolina back here on the seat stay, and we got Drama and Oscar hidden in here in a few spots. And on the front, I have a few features from Berm Peak. Now lastly, I actually put rev grips on this bike as well. You can tune them so that they actually move a little bit and provide a little bit more cushion. And on a hardtail, I feel like they're a good fit. If you want to know anything else specific about this bike, on our other channel, there's a two-video series, as I mentioned, just building and testing this bike and going into incredible detail. So as you can see, even though these are all mountain bikes, they all do very different things, and it's easy for me to decide which one I'm gonna grab if I'm doing any sort of riding. And so I'm really happy to give you a rundown on my current mountain bike fleet. I hope you found this video entertaining, useful. I hope you learned something today, and if you didn't, I hope you at least found this video entertaining. Thanks for riding with me today, and I'll see you next time.